about what's going on, it's also important to just explore that, make sure they feel safe at home, kind of explore what consequences they're afraid of, just to make sure that if that information is going to come out, that the teenager is safe. So some of the questions we want to know about with any GYN related to complaint. So the chief complaint, past medical history, any related symptoms, both GI and GYN, so related to abdominal pelvic pain, dysuria, discharge, vaginal bleeding. When teens are coming in with abnormal periods, we like to ask in detail their period history, so how old were they when it started, how regular is it, how often is it happening. We ask them how heavy has it been, and one way of asking that is like how often are they soaking through a pad or tampon, and then any family history of any bleeding. And then we also go through the social history, so the HEDS assessment, which stands for home, so asking who they live with, if they feel safe at home, education about their school environment, what activities they're involved in, if they're using any drugs or alcohol. Diet is focusing on any screening for like eating disorder, asking for sexual activity, so if they're sexually active, if they're using any contraception, if they've ever been pregnant or had STIs before, and screening for suicidal ideation. Another part of the sexual history that we often I feel like either forget to ask about or don't ask about is whether they're interested in emergency contraception, and so the screening question for that is whether they've had unprotected sex in the last 5 days. So we try to have our residents ask them that if they are sexually active as part of the HEDS assessment as well. So for the physical exam, again, we always start out with our ABCs, seeing if the patient is stable, so airway, breathing, circulation, and then looking for signs that can help us figure out what's going on. So for example, if the patient is tachycardic and pale, and they're coming in with vaginal bleeding, is that a sign of anemia? Whether they have bruising, petechiae, those could be signs of coagulopathy or bleeding disorder. If there's any signs of hyperandrogenism or an endocrine disorder, like if they have hirsutism. Abdominal exam, so it may come as a surprise, but then there are definitely patients who are obviously pregnant and like no one has noticed, no one has tested for it, so it has been missed. And then I'll talk more in detail about the GU exam as well. So the pelvic exam or GU exam, it consists of several parts. So an external GU exam, a bimanual exam, and a speculum exam. So kind of based on what the patient is coming in for, we decide what we need to do at this point. So anyone with a GU complaint should at least have an external exam, as this can show signs of trauma, lesions like herpes or warts, or sometimes anatomic abnormalities like an imperforate hymen. And then any sexually active female coming in with lower abdominal pain should at least have a bimanual exam. So looking for cervical motion tenderness, which is a sign of pelvic inflammatory disease, which I'll talk about more. So if they're not sexually active, we should at least be doing an external exam. And then in teens, we're not doing the speculum exam. So in the adult ED, like pretty much anyone with a GYN complaint gets a speculum exam. In teens, we're not doing it as much unless there's like a specific indication.
Such as?
Yeah, so basically, if there's concern for like a foreign body, like we've done it for like a retained tampon, if there's some other like unexplained bleeding, or some other like kind of pelvic pain, anything like that. But if we're just diagnosing like STDs or PID, that can be done with just a bimanual exam and like the urine, the STD testing. Yeah. Because we don't have to do the cervical swabs anymore for like gonorrhea and chlamydia. They can be like urine tests or vaginal tests. And some of the things we're looking at in triage in regards to the exam and vitals. So if they're not pregnant, but they're coming in with bleeding or pain, obviously any of the ABCs that are abnormal, if they're tachycardic and hypotensive, that could be a sign of shock, for example, from like either bleeding, like hypovolemic shock, or in the case of pregnancy, could be like an ectopic pregnancy. We'll talk about that more. Any kind of like pallor, petechiae, or bruising could be a sign of anemia or bleeding disorder. Altered mental status, dyspnea could also occur with anemia. And then if they're pregnant, anyone with like vaginal bleeding, pain, and then hypertension, headache, any neurological symptoms. And I'll go over in detail what these can be a sign of. So next I'll talk about a few of the common conditions we see and kind of what to look out for. So one of the most common presentations we see in teenage girls is abnormal uterine bleeding. This used to be called dysfunctional uterine bleeding, and they've now renamed it, so AUB. So this can be, has a variety of definitions. So bleeding between periods, very heavy bleeding, which can be defined as either lasting longer than 7 days, or basically using more than about 5 pads a day, or soaking a pad like every 1 to 2 hours. Periods that, cycles that are either too short or too long, or varying cycle length. There's a really broad differential for this, and it's nice to think about it kind of by category. So the first one up here is anovulatory uterine bleeding. So that's the most common reason we see for abnormal bleeding. So that's basically, especially in younger girls, the first 2 years of their menstrual cycle, they're not ovulating regularly. And so that can lead to irregular periods, basically. So that's the most common. The second most common is actually the bleeding disorder. So about 20% of girls that have abnormal periods actually have a bleeding disorder. And the most common is von Willebrand's disease. So other causes that we want to look for, obviously always rule out pregnancy. Infection can cause some irregular bleeding, and that includes, so UTI will have blood in the urine, but also sexually transmitted infections, and PID can cause some vaginal bleeding. Any kind of mass, so pelvic masses, vaginal masses, uterine masses, less common in kids than adults, but can still happen. Any of the endocrine disorders, basically because they're messing with the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. So problems with hypo or hyperthyroidism, for example, can cause irregular periods. Foreign body, the most common we see is a retained tampon that can cause irregular periods. And then any kind of chronic medical conditions like diabetes, kidney disease, liver disease. And then also medication, so that's important to ask about. So especially the birth control, like birth control pills can cause irregular periods. IUDs can cause some spotting. A lot of our patients who are on like anticoagulants, if they've had heme issues before, if they're on Coumadin or aspirin, they can have some irregular bleeding.
So is this often the first time we pick up on a blood disgorgation?
Yeah, often it's because they're coming with heavy periods. Yeah, so a lot of times it's diagnosed from this. Because pretty much in girls, like a lot of boys get diagnosed when they're babies after circumcisions because they have like profuse bleeding after circumcisions.
Mm-hmm.
But in girls, a lot of times just nothing pops up and then until they start menstruating. Yeah. And sometimes they've had other histories like, oh, bleeding with dental procedures or other surgeries. But if they've never really had any procedures done, it might not come up until they start menstruating. So these are just some hints to kind of narrow down this broad differential. So if they've always had heavy periods or any other bleeding history, like bleeding with dental procedures, we think about bleeding disorders. If they're having spotting, you want to think about if they're on birth control or maybe infection. If they're young and they've had very irregular cycles, think about anovulation. And then if they have any kind of endocrine changes, like acne can be a sign of hyperandrogenism. If they have other thyroid symptoms, we could think about endocrine causes. So the workup is really broad, and it really depends on what their history is. So everyone should get a pregnancy test no matter what. We do a CBC to see if they're anemic. If they've had any concern for prior bleeding, we'll also check their COAG. Sometimes we'll check them on Willebrand panel. If there's a specific concern for bleeding. If they have any other endocrine issues, we'll check thyroid. Sometimes like FSH, LH, that's done more outpatient, but thyroid sometimes we send from the ED. If they're sexually active, we do STI screening. And then imaging is not routinely indicated for bleeding unless there's some concern for like abdominal distension, abdominal pain, anything like that. Then we want to think more about looking for like a pelvic mass. And the treatment for abnormal bleeding is basically with hormones, so with estrogen and progesterone, which will stabilize the endometrium and control the bleeding. So here our treatment is guided on pretty much how severe it is. So if the bleeding is mild, they have a normal hemoglobin, we can do nothing, just kind of let them be. NSAIDs can actually help, which is kind of counterintuitive, but they have a local effect on the uterus and prostaglandins, where basically they can control bleeding. So sometimes we'll tell patients, like, just take NSAIDs while you're on your period for those 5 days or so, and that can help. Or they have an option to go on a daily OCP. So a lot of times I have this discussion with families. Sometimes you bring up birth control pills and they're like, no, I don't want that. I don't want anything. They kind of just leave it alone. Others really want a medication, so we can start them on birth control pills, which will lower their bleeding. If they have mild anemia, so hemoglobin 10 to 11, again, they have the option to go on birth control pills, where they can do just your regular 1 month, like daily pills. Or if they want to kind of control their bleeding faster, they can do one pill twice a day until bleeding stops and then taper to daily. And then for more severe bleeding, we can actually do like oral contraceptive taper. So this is one of the common ones that's used, where they take a pill 4 times a day for 4 days, 3 times a day for 3 days, and 2 times a day for 2 days. So patients who are admitted with heavy bleeding, a lot of times they'll be sent out on this kind of taper until their bleeding stops. And then we also start iron to help them. And then patients who are getting admitted, if their hemoglobin is, usually we do a cutoff of under 7, or if they're symptomatic, like they're having syncope, they're tired, dizzy, dyspneic, they'll come in for transfusion. And then the other treatment for this is IV estrogen. So the form of this is Premarin, and this will help actively stop the bleeding. Because the transfusion basically just treats their anemia and symptoms, but if they're continuing to have bleeding, then they need IV estrogen. So it's done as basically several doses over a 24-hour period. So they'll usually do this for 24 hours and then transition to the taper and then complete the taper outpatient.
Would this then correct it? It wouldn't in the long term.
Not in the long term. It'll just kind of stop the cycle. But usually, like, they'll need to stay on, if they're predisposed to having periods, they'll need to stay on birth control pills. Yeah. Unless they have a bleeding disorder, like von Willebrand's disease or something, where they need like factor or other treatments. And then other options that we have, so patients who cannot get estrogen, for example, if they've had a history of like DVTs or if they have cancer, they can get progesterone-only methods, so a common pill is Provera. There's some data coming out for the use of TXA for heavy periods as well. And then for patients who have von Willebrand's disease, they can actually get DDAVP. So the next condition we'll talk about is pelvic inflammatory disease. This is often underdiagnosed and missed because there's not really any exact criteria. So most cases are caused by gonorrhea and chlamydia, but also gram-negative rods and other organisms. And basically, we should suspect this diagnosis if there's a sexually active female coming in with lower abdominal pain, which is a lot of our patients. And that's why in this situation, the pelvic exam is really important. So doing a bimanual exam and assessing for cervical motion tenderness or adnexal tenderness. And then other signs they may have, sometimes fever, sometimes not, vaginal discharge. If you do a speculum exam, you would see discharge from the cervix, and then if they have positive gonorrhea, chlamydia.
Would you see, with cervical tenderness, is it exclusively a sign of PID, or are there other causes?
Usually it's a sign of PID, yeah, unless they have some other mass, but usually, yeah. And we would pretty much only be looking for it if we were like clinically concerned for PID.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess you could have other lesions that would be painful.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But usually it's a sign of it. But it'll kind of be in context with something else, like if they're also having pelvic pain or discharge, usually other symptoms as well. So for the testing, again, we used to do cervical swabs, kind of with a pap smear, but we don't do that anymore. So you can do the urine or vaginal. Actually, the CDC now is recommending that vaginal swabs are actually more accurate than the urine. So I know here we tend to do urine a lot, like in the teen clinic, they have vaginal swabs where they have teens actually like swab themselves, and they've been fine with doing it. I don't know if you guys seen anyone doing it here. I feel like not as much. We usually do urine.
We have the swabs, but I think
we have. I think a lot of people just don't know about it.
Rarely used.
Yeah. But they're a really good option. And then anyone we're testing, we should also do syphilis and HIV blood testing as well. And then the treatment depends on whether they're getting admitted or outpatient. But usually it says a cephalosporin and then doxycycline. So one big difference for the here we're pretty much just dealing with the outpatient treatment in the ED, but if they only have, you think it's gonorrhea or chlamydia, you don't think they have PID, they can just get the one-time treatment, like a shot of ceftriaxone will cover gonorrhea, and then the oral azithromycin will cover chlamydia, and then they're done. And a lot of times if we're suspicious or we're concerned for follow-up, we'll just go ahead and treat them. Because there's been so many patients where it takes 2 days for the results to come back, and then like we can't reach them, we can't find them. So we'll just treat. If there's PID, the treatment is basically the shot of ceftriaxone and then doxycycline for 14 days. So that's the big difference in those. Because a lot of patients don't pick up their prescription or don't finish it, I usually like to give them the azithro anyway, just so they're like covered for chlamydia here. So I'll do like ceftriaxone, azithro, and then send them home with the doxycycline.
And what is your threshold for admitting these kids versus treating them on an outpatient?
Yeah, so admitting, I think I have a slide on it. Yeah, so if they're ill appearing, if they're vomiting, so they're not going to tolerate their PO treatment, usually like if they have a fever, if there's an abscess, if they have already been on oral antibiotics and they're not improving, and then any high risk social situation. So if someone is like in foster care, if we're concerned that they're being trafficked, no follow-up, anything like that, then we'll just admit, yeah. And the reason for that is basically the consequences of not treating. So you can have direct consequences like a tube ovarian abscess, but then also there's long-term consequences such as like chronic pain, and then the big one is infertility. And then also because there's, the reason for that is basically once you have like inflammation in the tubes, there's scarring. And so with the scarring, you have higher risk of ectopic pregnancy, and then also, yeah, higher risk of infertility. So that's a criteria for admission. And then if they are going home, the other big thing that we need to talk to patients and more about is that they have to either abstain from sex for a week or use a condom, basically, until the treatment's over, and to notify their partner and that their partner has to be treated, because otherwise they'll just keep reinfecting each other. And some clinics actually have a policy where they do like expedited partner therapy, so they'll actually give, like they'll give an azithro packet for the partner to take at home, but they still have to like come in for the ceftriaxone, or they can just tell them to come in. So the next diagnosis is torsion. So this diagnosis gets missed a lot because it can have a pretty just non-specific presentation, as we were talking about earlier. So it's about 2.7% of cases of acute abdomen, and it can be in kids or teenagers. So the pathophysiology behind this is basically the ovary twists, obstructing basically the veins, and then you get swelling, which compresses the arteries. So you're not getting blood flow to the ovary. It's a much higher risk if there's a cyst or a mass, but can happen in normal ovaries as well. And even premenstrual girls can start getting ovarian cysts. And that's often an age group that's missed in too. So they'll usually have acute onset lower abdominal pain. It's pretty severe, can radiate to their back or their groin. Vomiting is a common sign, and then basically have acute abdomen. A lot of times it's confused with appy. So a lot of these patients will go for like a lap appy, and then they'll incidentally find it. So the initial imaging we do is a pelvic ultrasound. In order to see the ovaries, we have to have a full bladder, which is why we give the bolus before. And usually they'll see kind of like this image of the left ovary. It'll be an enlarged ovary. However, the hard thing with this is you can have a normal ultrasound. So because there's basically multiple sources of blood supply to the ovary and collaterals, you can still have some blood flow. So even if you have a normal ultrasound, it doesn't rule it out. So if the ultrasound is equivocal or it's normal, you're still suspecting it, then the next step would be further imaging. So MRI is better than CT. CT will show the large ovary, but doesn't show blood flow. But again, if like sometimes we don't have MRI available, so that's what happens, and a lot of times it's a delayed diagnosis because we can't get it till the next day. So again, if there's high suspicion, sometimes they'll go to the OR for laparoscopy. But yeah, it's definitely, there's been a lot of data showing that, unfortunately, it's pretty common to have like several days delay in diagnosis.
That's, I mean,
does
that's
it die
terrible.
Like the testicle?
Yeah. Yeah.
After like testicle, it seems like after what, 2 days?
Yeah, the testicle can actually die in like hours. Like the recommendation is OR within like 6 hours for the testicle.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure say of the exact time of the ovary. I think you have a little longer, like up to 12 to 24 hours. But no, yeah, that's what we were talking about. Yeah, not at all. And we're saying a lot of it's just because you can't see it, like they come in with abdominal pain. We don't know, but yeah, we had a case in residency that was missed. Like, it took 2 days to get imaging. Like, they couldn't see anything on ultrasound, and then they were kind of debating CT or MRI. And then by the time they got imaging, went to the OR, the ovary was dead. So that was like two days later.
So
yeah.
That they're a rollout ovarian torsion. We still don't brush them off like we do those.
Yeah.
Cells.
Yeah. It's
is
so
there
true.
A reason?
No. Yeah. I don't know. I think it's just, it's not as common, I guess, and gets missed a lot. Yeah.
Mm.
So I don't know. But yeah, it's unfortunate. So, and that's usually any girl that comes with abdominal pain, we always ultrasound, like basically abdomen and pelvis, to make sure we look at the ovaries too.
Well, not any time, but when it's one-sided.
Yeah, one-sided. Yeah, not like constipation, but like, one-sided, especially like acute. Even if it's like on the right side, we'll do like abdomen and pelvis. Yeah. So I'm going to talk about some of the issues around pregnancy, since we do see some pregnant patients as well. So this is like one big point through this talk, but like always test for pregnancy. Because a lot of teens are lying about it. A lot of teens don't, it takes them a while to figure out they're pregnant because they're having irregular periods. And again, they can have irregular ovulation, so that's not enough to rule it out. It's important to just diagnose it as soon as possible so they can get where they need to go, whether it's prenatal care, abortion services, and to help prevent any complications. Because a lot of teenagers will have complications from pregnancy because they're delaying seeking care. And a lot of them, they don't go to the doctor regularly. The ED might be like their only point where they're accessing healthcare. So it's important to catch it. This, I just pulled a few studies that I thought were really interesting about teenagers kind of lying about their pregnancy status. So there's one where they looked at pregnant teens in the ED. So only 8% revealed that they were pregnant at triage. 10% of pregnant teens said they've never been sexually active. There was another study that said 11% of pregnant teens said there was no way they could be pregnant. The third study was looking at teens that came in with like GYN complaints. Only half of them had a pregnancy test. I feel like here we're pretty good about like getting pregnancy tests on everyone, but definitely gets missed at some places. And then the last study, they looked at pregnant teens who had prior ED visits where the pregnancy wasn't diagnosed, like they hadn't been tested, and some of them were even second or third trimester where like they're obviously showing and they like no one realized that they were pregnant or tested them. So it definitely happens. So we'll talk about a few of these conditions that, again, we can see the kind of initial presentation here. So ectopic pregnancy is when basically, the ovum implants usually on the tube, occurs in about 2% of pregnancies. And then it's actually a high mortality rate in teens, because they're not coming in. So this will be acute onset pain. They can have pain and or bleeding or both. And then if it's ruptured, they can present basically in shock. So this is diagnosed by looking at the HCG and then transvaginal ultrasound, which we don't do here. But one of the ways we can see it is free fluid on the fast. So, for example, if a teenage girl comes in shock, that's one thing that we can kind of quickly do and see. And one thing that one diagnosis that we should keep in mind in this age group. So we'll urgently transfer them, but basically the options are surgical treatment, so to remove the pregnancy, and the medical, or if it's early and they're stable, then medical treatment is actually methotrexate, which is a either a single dose or a multi-dose regimen.
To terminate the pregnancy?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And is the fallopian tube like able to be saved, or?
So it depends on the size and if it's ruptured. So if it's really small and the patient's like totally stable, they usually just give them methotrexate and then they're fine, and then they'll like follow up in 48 hours. But if it's ruptured, then they have to go to surgery. Yeah, and then it depends. Sometimes they just take out the tube, but it depends. Yeah. So a spontaneous abortion, basically the same thing as miscarriage. So there's a few different types. So threatened is they're just coming in with bleeding, but they're not passing any products yet. Inevitable, basically the cervix is open, so there's bleeding, it's kind of starting. Incomplete is they're already passing products, and incomplete is they've already passed all the products and it's finished basically, and this is in the first 20 weeks. So again, we're transferring for this. And then septic abortion is basically an infectious complication, so can occur with spontaneous abortion or if there was basically a botched like surgical abortion. So, which again, teens are higher risk if they're going to like unskilled providers, trying to do it themselves, trying to get pills online. There's like a lot of these like horror stories. And actually, I think one of the residents told me they had a case at Highland of like a teenager who like came from another country, kind of went somewhere like random to do it and came in with like a really bad pelvic infection. So we have this like broad spectrum antibiotics and transferring. So issues that can cause bleeding after 20 weeks, so placenta previa, where basically the placenta is kind of obstructing the entrance to the cervix, they'll present with painless vaginal bleeding, and then a placental abruption, they'll have bleeding and then like severe pain, and this is after 20 weeks. And then the other emergencies we can have are preeclampsia and eclampsia. Was anyone here when there was that patient with eclampsia? It was like last year. Yeah, and like no one knew
no
she was pregnant.
Knew.
Yeah, Brian had like, it was like a crazy case, this girl.
Everyone was so focused on the seizures.
Yeah.
The outside hospital called and said,
exactly.
We're bringing someone in
yeah.
who has seizures.
Yeah, she came in like
the
status.
Seizures, the seizures,
yeah.
The seizures.
Yeah.
And nobody had done an abdominal exam, and finally we're changing her into a gown and go,
yeah. Yeah, it's crazy. And she hadn't even been seen by a neurologist.
Well, was that
and
the one? I don't even know if we did an abdominal one right away. We,
yeah, I don't think anyone saw.
Somebody
I think
said, let's
she went
just
to the,
do a beta-HCG
yeah.
on
yeah.
the blood because
yeah.
we're not going to get pee right now.
Yeah.
Let's just do it. And then she was about to go upstairs.
Yeah, I came back. I think she was in the scanner or something.
The
and then the result
yeah.
came back.
Yeah.
yeah.
That was a rough day.
Can definitely happen. Yeah, so preeclampsia is the triad of proteinuria, edema, and hypertension. And then eclampsia is preeclampsia with any signs of cerebral dysfunction. So it can be seizures, could be altered mental status, and progress to coma. So signs to look out for, they can present with like severe headache, vision changes, blurry vision, nausea, vomiting. They can have signs of increased intracranial pressure. So it can be after, it's after 20 weeks. But also can occur postpartum. So if you see someone who like just recently had a baby, sometimes we see you know new moms coming into the ED and they're coming in with severe headache. Can occur actually the latest reported case I saw in the literature was up to 8 weeks after, which is pretty late. So definitely something to not miss.
Is that because of incomplete delivery of the placenta or?
I wonder. Yeah, I'm actually not sure if it's due to retained products. I don't think necessarily. Yeah. I think you can still have this. I don't know if they know the exact mechanism. It's something related to like the placental blood vessels and the flow, but I don't think you have to have retained products. Yeah. So, but yeah, I'm not sure of the exact pathophysiology for like postpartum. Does anyone know the treatment? Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. So MAG, which for that girl was started immediately. And then if they're still pregnant, the definitive treatment is delivery. So they have to have virtual delivery. Another diagnosis is a molar pregnancy, which is really rare, but can happen. I know they have a case at Highland of this also. So it's basically like an abnormal pregnancy. So it's a non-viable fertilized egg, basically. So there's a few different ways it could happen. You can have basically sperm that like duplicates and then is fertilized with an empty egg, or you can have an egg with two sperm, but it's basically a collection of like abnormal DNA, so non-viable, more common in adolescents, and they have very high HCG, like in 100,000, and it'll present kind of vague also, like abdominal pain and vomiting. And then one really interesting presentation, which is what they had at the case at Highland, was it can cause hyperthyroidism because HCG stimulates your thyroid hormone. So they had a patient who came in basically with like thyroid storm, like hypertensive, tachycardic, had like some neurological changes, and then was found to have a positive pregnancy test. And when they did the ultrasound, had a molar pregnancy.
Was that this past week?
No, this was like last year. Did they have one recently you heard about?
Well, they just had a kid coming in, a teenager with thyroid storm.
Oh, okay. Interesting. Yeah, no, I had this one was like last year. Yeah. But yeah, so anyone with thyroid storm or any thyroid issue should also have a pregnancy test. Yeah.
How do you diagnose this on ultrasound?
It looks like, so the classic name is like snowstorm, but it's just like this crazy ball of cells. Like it looks very abnormal.
Intrigue.
Like in a picture. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, and you'll see it on ultrasound. Like it just looks like a bunch of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So other things that we can see in the ED related to contraception, so especially now our teen clinic is putting in a lot of IUDs and the arm implants. So IUDs can cause irregular bleeding, pain, very rarely, less than 1% of the time, they can migrate and cause uterine perforation. So any patient that has a known IUD, if they're coming in with severe abdominal pain and like acute abdomen, that's one thing to suspect is whether their IUD has moved. And we can look at that with bedside ultrasound. Same with the Nexplanon, which goes into the arm, can also cause some spotting. And then both of these are progestin-based, so don't increase the risk of DVT. And on the other hand, any of the methods that have estrogen, like birth control pills, the patch, can increase your risk of DVT. So any patients coming with DVT or PE, that's one of the risk factors we look at. Emergency contraception. So there's two main types we have here, Plan B or Ella. So from talking to our adolescent medicine doctors, they're recommending Ella is more effective.
Is
so
that newer?
Yeah, it's in the last few
not
years.
Around when
yeah. Yeah, 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 exactly. Yeah, Ella's in the last few years. So Plan B is most effective in the first like 72 hours, but Ella has been shown to still work up to 5 days. And then the other big difference is Ella is more effective for patients over 75 kilos, which is pretty common for a lot of our patients. So they're recommending that we use this one, which can basically inhibit ovulation and prevent implantation. So again, another reason why it's important to ask our patients, like, have they had unprotected sex in the last 5 days? And then also we're offering this to our patients who've been assaulted as well.
We used to give them Plan B before they even left the ED.
Yeah.
I find we don't do that anymore.
Yeah, now, I don't know, the times I've had to do it for, like, the SAFE exam, yeah, we have to get it from pharmacy. Sometimes they don't have it. It's been sometimes an issue, but I feel like it should be more readily available. So, yeah. So, especially if, like, it's time sensitive, so.
Is Plan B still,
Plan B is it's a one pill basically. There's like one pill and then a second one, like 12 to 24 hours later. And then it will often prescribe because sometimes insurances will cover one and not the other one, or like one will be more expensive than the other one. So we'll just write like, you know, prescribe one, but then we'll say give the other one if it's not available, to make sure that they can get something. Yeah. And then if they are getting it, so just let them know that they can have irregular periods after. Again, they may already be pregnant. That may not show up on a test. So if they miss their period, they should still get pregnancy testing. And then it might interfere with any of their, if they're already on a method or if they're on other medications. And this is true in general for anyone who's on like birth control pills or especially anything with estrogen. Because of the CYP3A4, which is a liver enzyme that does drug metabolism, they can mess with each other and make it less effective. So especially like the seizure medications, a lot of them interact with birth control and make it less effective. So some of the key points, so everyone should get tested for pregnancy, even if they say they're not sexually active. Are sexually active females coming with lower abdominal pain, should have a bimanual exam. If we're concerned for STIs or PID, treating, not waiting for results, transferring for any pregnancy-related complications, and then as we talked about, forgot to put up here, but torsion, if we have a suspicion for any girl coming with acute onset, one-sided abdominal pain, to evaluate for torsion as well. Yeah. Any questions?
I wonder if we need to have a new policy surrounding the ovarian torsion.
Yeah.
Yes.
At least make that very clear, because
yeah.
Sounds like consequences of missing it are just as high as a
for sure.
testicular torsion.
Yeah. Yeah.
But because there are so many distracting possible differential diagnoses, it's not prioritized as heavily. It's
even
like
when
it's
they rule out torsion, we do not treat it the same as a rule out testicular torsion.
Yeah.
Testicular torsions are up in ultrasound like within
45
minutes.
Yeah.
We said the last one that I was on from triage, literally from triage, they went out for ultrasound. I went to the doc, they ordered
why don't
it,
we do this
they were ready, and we said,
girls that have one-sided, I mean, that's pretty typical.
One-sided.
Yeah.
It's like sudden onset, one-sided
sudden
pain,
onset
usually
one-sided.
With vomiting. Yeah. Yeah, it's true.
Interesting.
Shit, it's an interesting point.
There's a research.
I know, right?
Yeah,
exactly. It's true.
So the main things we should look at for at triage would be just the abdominal pain.
Yeah.
For any, you know, emergent.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, sudden onset abdominal pain. Yeah. And then any,
without bleeding.
Yeah. Yeah. And then bleeding. And then, we always look at like abnormal vitals. But, yeah.
You generally have bleeding with torsion?
Mm-hmm. Oh, no. I just meant bleeding. Bleeding
is
like a triage. But, no, with torsion, usually just like sudden onset pain. Yeah.
Interesting.
The ruptured ovarian cysts.
Yeah, that's a common one too. Yeah, and then we see a lot of girls with ovarian cysts, and I mean, if they have a cyst, they're much higher risk of torsion too. So,
is bedside ultrasound sensitive enough to pick up the ovarian cysts and the?
Yeah, we can't see ovaries well enough on it. They can see more with the transvaginal, but since we don't have it here, I don't think so, because the radiologists have kind of been against it because they're trained in like only pediatric, and I think they don't want to be liable for interpreting like pregnancy related ultrasounds or transvaginal.
The age of menstruation is getting lower and lower.
Yeah, exactly.
I think it's something
9. No, it's crazy.
They're going to have to address it.
Right now this step is just to transfer.
All right,
yeah.
Awesome.